Some raw foodists say sugar, even from fruit feeds, yeast and mold, fungus and cancers. What do you think about fruit?
I love fruit. Fruit's about happiness. And I had blueberries this morning and a little bit. I had a half an avocado and some blueberries this morning. A little bit of peanut butter. And what else did I have? This real, and a little bit, actually, this is a little bit of grape juice right here that I'm drinking right now. I absolutely love fruit, but it depends on the person's situation. If a person's been abusing a massive amount of sugar their whole life and they're riddled with candida type of problems or candida or yeast problems, then they need to actually fast from that, right, to bring things back into balance. Is it a good idea to live your life without fruit? And I would say no, because fruit's about happiness. Fruit is a celebratory expression of the, it's like the ego of the tree ultimately, or the plant or the vine. So we're kind of in celebrating. It's kind of a up happy vibe. Fruit is very happy. But again, if someone's abused sugar, then there's been too many ups already. So they need to have a few downs or like bottom it out for a while and sort their metabolism out. So that's where I sit on that. Now there are certain situations where I would say, you know, stay off fruit for 2 years. There are certain fruit situations where I say stay off of fruit for 2 months. It could be that widely varied. Or I could say there's certain situations where I say stay off of fruit for 2 weeks. Do no sugar for 2 weeks. Generally, if people do a no sugar diet, including fruit sugar, they're going to lose weight. They're going to feel better. Energy is eventually going to normalize. They're going to get more into a ketosis state. Because as soon as I have anything like this grape juice right here, my blood sugar goes up. No question about it. If I'm constantly up with a constant hit of fruit sugar, even all day long, eventually that's going to irritate my system. It's going to irritate my pancreas. It's going to irritate my system because I'm constantly have to produce insulin to deal with it. So fruit is part of an overall balanced diet. It isn't the only thing in a diet, but it's a part of an overall balanced diet.
What do you think about dairy foods and eggs? You mentioned you think some dairy is acceptable. So can you expand on that whole topic?
Well, I like eggs, and eggs are good because of the choline in the egg yolk. And there's also, to some degree, some omega-3 in the egg yolk. So there's things in the egg yolk that are very good for the eyes and the brain. So generally, when you have like a child that's growing up and, you know, you can be, it's easier to be vegan from, say, 20 to 40 because you're already developed. But in the developing phase, things like dairy products, things like eggs, what else would I put into there? Even like a little bit of herbs that come from animal sources. So for example, I was talking about pearl as a calcium source. There's other ones. These types of things make more sense for either the young and developing or the aged, once you're say 50 and beyond, because you just need more of those nervous system protective and developmental substances. Now that means that animal foods have something to do with nervous system for sure. There's no question, because I've seen, especially with vegans, if you don't get, for example, here's one that was, that comes from a plant source ultimately, but it's one of these things that I would say children really need. And most people are getting it from fish oil. And that's algae oil, right? So the algae or the omega-3s in algae oil. If you have fish oil, you're getting these omega-3s that are marine source, DHA and EPA. There's the terrestrial ones, say from hemp seed or flax seed or primrose, that's ALA. So there's ultimately three omega-3s. Two of them are marine in origin. Those two marine in origin can originally come into the fish from the algae. So you could jump to the algae. Now, this is very important for developing children and for the elderly, to for cognitive functioning and development. So I would recommend, like what I do is I have right here, this is a product. This is, I love this product. This is a product I helped develop, but my cousin actually really finally figured out the secret of it, which is this is an omega-3 from algae oil as a liquid that I was trying to encapsulate this for years. My cousin came along, he's just put in a squeeze bottle and it just goes in like that, so much easier. And then the big problem with this type of thing is, even though it's from algae, it tastes like fish. So my cousin eventually found out you could put limonene in there, which is an essential oil. It's the essential oil that's associated with lemons. So it has a lemon flavor, but it covers up, it beautifully covers up the fishy flavor. So it actually tastes relatively good. And kids like it. So that's really important. Now, in the old days, they used to take cod liver oil and be like, okay, kid, you're going to take your spoonful of cod liver oil, which all original indigenous people of this region, especially in the further north, Arctic conditions, Nordic countries, Pacific Northwest regions, they were huge on cod and cod oil for brain development. And again, they worked it out to like, hey, you're going to drink this cod liver oil, kid. And kids would be like, ah, oh, this is gross. But the parents would force it in because they knew it was so important for brain and eye development. Now we've got it down to, hey, we don't have to kill any fish. We could just go directly to the algae and do it that way. And algae are chlorophyll producing organisms in this case. And so therefore you're actually eating a plant. So that's another one that's kind of, it's kind of a quasi plant animal, but it's mostly, it's like three quarters plant really, because it has its chlorophyll. So that's another one that's in that quasi zone there, but I really recommend it for developing children. Also for moms, postpartum depression has been correlated to a deficiency in DHA, which is that omega-3 fatty acid from marine origin. So if you can give moms a lot of that, especially right after they give birth, it's really important. Plus, they'll produce more DHA in the breast milk for the baby.
What do you think about beef, chicken, pork, turkey, and fish in terms of their impact on our health?
Well, I don't eat any of those things, and I haven't eaten any of those things in over 30 years. And I just promoted a video. One of my people in my inner circle, she just put out a video on parasites in pork, and she's pouring soda on the piece of pork, and you can see the worms come out. It's really scary. It's frightening, actually. It's one of the reasons why I don't eat those things. I mean, Sushi is notoriously a source of tapeworm infections and just things like that. It's just, I'm not a real big fan. Now, if you're going to eat those things, if you're going to eat any kind of a chicken or poultry or any kind of fish, cook it. Definitely cook it. Do not eat it raw, because you're just allowing the parasites to pass right into you. So this is why we cook, actually, those things, because we have to have some kind of a buffer. Because we don't have the ability to fight off parasites the way, say, a wild animal can. We're too domesticated. So we can become very susceptible to parasite infections. And in fact, with COVID-19, let's talk about that for a second. I've been saying, I was taught this by my teachers 25 years ago. They said, you get all the parasites out of your system, you can't get a cold, cough, flu, or fever. Because the parasite itself is a factory of those things. And the parasite itself deactivates or disables your immune system so that your immune system can't keep the viral load down. That's what I was taught. I took that advice to heart. Many things I added on to that, but that was one of the fundamental bases of all my cleansing, actually. Whenever we get people on a cleanse, we immediately go after the parasites. We get them on herbs that are parasite killers. Strangely and interestingly, under research of COVID-19, were anybody, any doctors in the world able to prevent any kind of COVID flu / influenza development prophylactically, preventatively? And the answer was yes. There was a group of doctors that were able to 100% have 100% prevention, and they were using ivermectin. Ivermectin is a well-known dewormer and parasite killer. So if you don't have any, if you take enough ivermectin, it kills all the parasites in your system, you can't get a cold. Now, try it yourself. I tried that. I've been testing that out for 25 years. I am absolutely convinced it's true. At this point in my life, there's no way I'm getting a cough, cold, flu, fever, anything. And I've been exposed as much as anybody. I traveled the world straight for 26 years. I was in planes, trains, automobiles, the whole thing. Now, I not only do parasite killing herbs, and I don't do them every day, but I do them consistently. I might do 30 days and then not do it for 3 months, then do another 30 days and not do it for 3 months, just because of exposure in the environment or a dog comes and licks your face or something. But I also do the immune modulatory herbs like the medicinal mushrooms, all the great Chinese herbs, all the great Amazonian herbs, depends on what mood I'm in, all the great Vedic herbs, again, depends on what mood I'm in. And most of my diet today, I would say, is more herbal. Because I'm more interested in that. That's, again, a developmental thing. When you're a child, you need food. As a middle-aged adult, it's more about superfoods because you don't need as much of the calories, but it's nice to have some of those highly modulated superfoods like goji berries or aloe vera or maca or hemp seed or things like that. And that's what people get in their smoothies. Then you get to a point where you're like, I don't even really want that. It's too many calories. You know how it is as you get older. It's like you eat anything, you gain weight. You're like, well, my God, I just ate one meal. I'm still gaining weight. What's going on? You generally at that age where I'm at, 50 or above, you want to get to a point where you're like, hey, let's just do herbs and do as many herbs as we can. And they're very good appetite suppressants, by the way. Herbal tea is an amazing appetite suppressant. And that's kind of where I'm at. But it's also immune modulatory, so that you can modulate your immune system, so your immune system functioning properly. And what I mean by that, let me just clarify that a little bit more. Celery is a great food. I love celery. I'm a big fan of celery. I've grown celery. I love being a grower of the things that I talk about. That's one of the things that I think that differentiates me as a nutritionist. Pretty much if I'm going to say something, I've grown it. But celery is like good food for your bones. Celery is great food for your intestines. It's indirectly an immune system food because it's good for your bones and your intestines. And it's not affronting your system with a bunch of insults. It's your immune system goes, okay, we're not irritated. Everything's good. But it's not a direct food nutrition for the immune system. Medicinal mushrooms like reishi mushroom and chaga mushroom and lion's mane mushroom and tremedes, these are direct foods for the immune system. They provide nutrition for the immune system. And therefore, your immune system can modulate up and produce more immune system weaponry, up to 7 different weapons that normally it would not be able to produce in a white blood cell. That's such an important concept. This is, people ask me like, oh, nutrition, is it really important? It's like, oh, it's really important when you really understand what it's capable of doing, because you can sure live without medicinal mushrooms, but not optimally, because you're not getting the full and complete nutrition for your immune system, your white blood cells and your NK cells, et cetera. So that's something I wanted to just point out, is that's part of the overall picture as well. And that's one of the reasons why I focus on herbs rather than pork or chicken or poultry. It's like, we don't need that stuff anymore. We've had enough of that stuff in our lives or in our genetics. I'd recommend looking somewhere else.